Well, this morning we started a new series called Killing Goliath. And I kind of stole that a little bit from somebody else, but I love that title because we all face Goliaths. We all face giants. And so all throughout this month, and even into next month, we're going to be talking about eight giants. First, we'll deal with Goliath today, and then we're going to actually pull out seven more giants from the life of David. We're not just picking random topics. David, 50 chapters are dedicated to David in Scripture. So there is no way we're going to cover the whole life of David. But we've done a study, and we really feel like there are seven major giants that David faced other than Goliath. And we're going to be talking about those all throughout. We've got a couple of guest speakers. I'll be doing about six out of eight of these messages, and I'm really excited about this series. Now, even if you are not a church person at all, you probably are familiar with the story of David and Goliath. It's 58 verses found in 1 Samuel 17. It would take me a little while to read it to you, so I've kind of employed a little bit of a helper this morning. I have this young person. She's kind of a young person that I actually found on the internet. Found a kid on the internet. That's weird. But anyway, she's going to help me and just tell you the story.
Goliath was a giant. He can fight God's people. The soldiers don't want to fight Goliath. He's too big and strong. But a boy named David was not afraid. He prayed to God. There was no stone that Goliath. He hit himself with the forehead.
Yeah.
He never bothered the people again. David was a hero. Give me five for David.
Everybody turn to your neighbor. Just give five for David. Give five for David. There you go. There you go. Awesome. Awesome. Well, I could not have said it better. We can just go home and we're good, right? Well, where do we start with this? This is such a big story, and truthfully, we could have done a whole series just on this one story, but let's go ahead and attack it just a little bit. Maybe we can start here. What or who is your Goliath? Goliath is this. Now get this. Goliath is the giant of repetition. Everybody say repetition. If you're thinking of some area in your life that you've only dealt with one time, then that's not your Goliath. Goliath is the giant of repetition. It is the destructive monster that keeps reappearing in your life. Now, we all know this to be true. The biggest battles that we fight are not the battles that we hit once or twice, but they're the battles that keep repeating themselves, right? The Bible even says in this story that Goliath didn't just come one time, but he came back 40 days in a row. The giants of our lives, they just keep coming back. And so what might that be for you? I was trying to think of just an easy one. I'll reveal a bunch of them in my life through this series, but I have this, how many of you would join me? I have this same 5 or 10 pounds that keeps reappearing in my life. You know what I'm saying? Am I the only one? It's more of a winter 5 or 10, right? It likes to come back in the winter months. And then usually I defeat the giant in the spring months, but then it comes back, you know? And so, you know, I'll play the never ever game. You know, I'll lose that 10 pounds and then I'll say, well, I will never, ever, ever do that late night ice cream again, you know. In fact, ice cream's just bad from now on, you know, and that's just the way it is. It's no longer, the cheeseburger, it's no longer a part of my life. It's just not going to, I yesterday for the first time ate at High Boy Cheeseburgers here, first time ever. I've lived here a while. I have a new Goliath in my life. It's called High Boy Cheeseburgers. And so we play these never ever games, don't we? We defeat it, and Pastor, I will never ever do that again. And then the next day happens, and well, I will never ever ever. And I'm serious this time. I'll never ever ever. You get what I'm saying? Goliath is that giant that's hard to defeat. It keeps on coming back. In fact, I would say it like this. Goliath is the bully, everybody say bully, that makes you his continual victim. Now, maybe somewhere in your past you can think about a bully scenario. Hopefully you're not being bullied right now. And if you are, I want you to come to me because me and my boy Paul, we're going to take care of business. I don't like bullies. How many of you don't like bullies? That's right. Wayne knows where to bury the body. We will take care of the issue. We'll lead them to Christ first. It won't be a problem. They'll go to heaven. But I don't like the bully scenario. I don't. And so anytime I see somebody strong picking on somebody weak, even if I'm not supposed to be involved, I've gotten in a lot of trouble in shopping malls for this. I just like to be involved because it just bugs me. I can try to think of the first bully scenario that I had in my own life. I think it was the fifth grade. His kid was name was Bruce, and he came in from out of town, and he was kind of big, and he wasn't real smart, but he was big, and he ruled his tiny universe at Webster Elementary School with an iron fist. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And the thing about a bully is this: is they rule by fear and intimidation, right? See, giants are a lot like bullies. They rule the tiny universes of our lives with fear and intimidation. They like to make themselves look bigger than they actually are. In fact, if you guys can circle back, that series verse that we're really going to be looking at this every single week, the Bible tells us when God was actually calling David to be the giant killer that he ultimately would be, the Bible gives us this verse. The Bible says to Samuel, who was the prophet who anointed David, he said, do not look at his outward appearance or on his height or stature. How many of you know bullies rely on appearance, right? If you're going to be a bully, man, you better front, right? You better bulk yourself up because that's what bullies have to do. But giant killers, they don't rely on that. The Bible says when God called David, he wasn't looking at the outward appearance, but God was looking at what? He was looking at the heart. So it doesn't matter how small you feel today, you can be a giant killer just like David was, but it won't be because of your greatness or because of your stature or because of your bank account or whatever. It will be because of your heart after God. David was a man after God's own heart. How many of you want to be after God's heart? Amen. See, giants are bullies that they count on your lack of courage. There's this intentionality about a bully, isn't there? I mean, every time I've ever faced one, what happens is they get you on their heels because they come at you so hard and so fast, and you're just a little bit like shocked by it. Like seriously, you're talking about my mama right now? Yeah, I mean, we're gonna do this, right? Right, and that's kind of what you feel like, and you lack that intentionality because often you don't even know the war is happening, but they prepared, right? They knew they were gonna steal your milk money that day. And so they show up prepared. And so they count on two things. They count on your lack of intentionality / courage. And they also count on your lack, and in fact, I would even say our lack, of organization. Think about this. Every bully scenario that's ever happened in any school, workplace, you name it, that bully counts on one thing: collective disorganization. How many of you know, no matter how big the bully was, if all the nerds got together, they could take the bully, right? But the bully knows there's not enough courage, there's not enough organization, and so you could have your own little Revenge of the Nerds movie happening in your life if there was just collective organization. Now, here's our goal in this series. The amazing story of David and Goliath, I believe God put it in the Bible to both organize us collectively and motivate us individually. Let me say that again. The story of David and Goliath, as we study it, you're not only going to be motivated individually, but what I am praying is that we raise up a church of giant killers. Amen? That because the Bible says one can put 1,000 to flight, two can put 10,000 to flight. What would happen if 500 of us got organized? Amen? And we began saying, collectively, devil, we are no longer going to accept your bully reign over us, but we're going to get organized and become giant killers. Well, let's take the background of this story and just look at it a little bit. This story is an amazing duel that took place between David and a giant 3,000 years ago in the land of Palestine. Now, Palestine is a very interesting place. A lot of it's on the news today, and let me just, because you probably don't get this, let me just tell you a little bit of the geography of Palestine or Israel itself. Palestine is really broken up into three major areas. On the eastern border of the country, there's this beautiful mountain range. And that is where the famous cities of the Bible, Jerusalem, Bethlehem, all those cities are there. And Israel, or Israelites, are a people of that mountain range. Now, all the way across the land, so if this is the eastern border, the mountain range, all the way across the land on the western border of the country is the sea. And bordering that sea, and in fact, just before you get to that sea, is a land that would look a lot like Kansas. You know what I'm talking about. All plain and flat. I don't know how people keep from committing suicide, but it's all there, right? And the Bible tells us that the Israelites, they were people that lived in the mountains, but the Palestinians, the Palestine people, they were the ones who lived on the sea and in the plains. They were people of the sea. And the Bible says that Israel worshiped the one true God, Jehovah God. But the Palestinians, they worshiped a God called Dagon. And that God was a God of sensuality, a God of war, a God of perversion. It was a false God made up by man. It was an excuse to sacrifice their kids and to sexually pervert themselves in the process of worshiping their false God. Now, between these two lands, you have the mountains, you have the sea, you have the plains, but right in the middle is something called the Shephelah. Everybody say the Shephelah. Now, the Shephelah is this beautiful place in Israel that represents the foothills of the mountains. It would be like getting across Kansas, if you can survive the drive, all the way, I'm hard on Kansas today, sorry, all the way to the foothills of the Rocky Mountains, right? And you start getting in some beautiful areas. There's vineyards there, there's streams, there's valleys and ridges. And if you study out this, not just biblically, but even extra-biblically, you will find that the Israelites and the Palestinians, the people who lived on the coast, people who lived in the mountains, they were constantly fighting over the Shephelah. Because the people in the mountains, they needed to be able to get to the sea. And the people in the sea, they needed to be able to get to the mountains. And so most of the major biblical battles we have take place right in the middle, right in the Shephelah area. Well, like all giants do, the Palestinians, they were not satisfied with just having the sea, just having the plains. They wanted it all. And so the Bible tells us that the Philistines, they were not satisfied. They wanted it all. And so the Bible tells us that the Philistine army, they gathered themselves together and they headed into the Shephelah. They were heading towards the mountains. They were going to cross this foothill country all the way into the mountains. They wanted the sea, they wanted the plains, they wanted the Shephelah, they wanted the mountains, they wanted everything. Now, if you know anything about giants, you know this. Giants, they always want more. They're never satisfied until they have all of you and everything and everyone you love. If you have an addiction in your life that you think, well, Pastor, I've kind of found balance. Can I just tell you, the word balance and addiction should never go together. Because your addiction is just going to keep stealing from you. Your addiction is something called an appetite. Everybody say an appetite. And now, have you ever at the end of your Thanksgiving meal said, I will never ever eat again? Anybody out there? But then about 3 o'clock, it kicks in, right? And you're like, I could really use some pie. You know, because your appetite, it only knows one thing. It only knows one word. What is it? More. I want more. An addiction is an appetite gone crazy. It wants more. It wants more. It wants more. The giant of addiction in your life, you cannot make peace with it. No, giants always want more. The Philistines, they're not crossing this land to make a deal. They're not. They're not crossing this land So that somehow they can sign a treaty. Now listen, the Israelites, they have no choice. And so the Bible tells us this. King Saul, he gathers his army together. He heads out of the mountains into the Shephelah to meet the Philistine army. And they all meet up in a place called the Valley of Elah. The Valley of Elah is a powerful place in Scripture. There were many battles fought there. The Bible describes that this valley, it's more than just a valley, by the way. It's like a canyon. It's about a mile wide in the middle. There's a beautiful stream, that probably the same brook that David picked his 5 rocks from, going right down the middle. And the Bible says that on one side, the Israelite army, or extra-biblical sources tell us, they encamped on the northern side, and the Philistine army were there on the southern side. And here's the deal. There's a lot of trash talking happened back and forth. This is what guys my age do instead of fighting, because I'm too pretty to fight, to be honest with you. But when I get in some kind of, I'm a little bit like, oh, you want this? You want it right now? You know, kind of thing. And then the other guy's like, well, I'll give it to you. You know, that kind of thing. That's sort of how we fight, you know, at our age, because, you know, we could hurt something. And so that's a little bit of what was going on. You know, there's a lot of, like, posturing, you know, back and forth, but nobody's throwing any punches, you know. Nobody's really going to get hurt. You know, we just don't want to look bad, you know, kind of thing. And the problem was, if the Philistine army, if they crossed the valley, the canyon, and they started going up, well, then Israel would have the tactical advantage. You always want high ground. And on the other hand, if the Israelites, if they crossed and they started going up the other side, well, then the Philistines, they would have the tactical advantage. And so nobody wanted to give up. Now, what's interesting about this, Israel had no choice but to go to the Valley of Elah. If they had not fought the Philistines that day, the Philistines were going to come and they were going to kill every fighting man. They were going to rape the women. They were going to enslave the children. There was no choice. We are all familiar with canyons that are actually God-ordained battlefields. Can I tell you this? Refusing to engage a giant is the same thing as surrendering to that giant. If you decide, well, Pastor, I, cool thoughts today, but, you know, me and my giants, you know, we've kind of made friends and it's all right. No. Listen. Refusing to fight your giant is akin to saying to that giant, I surrender, come take anything you want. They had no choice. Now, what's interesting about this story is they, and I see this in the lives of God's good people, they showed up, but then they refused to fight. Israel's on one side, kind of fronting the other side. The Philistines are over there, but nobody has the courage to fight. And so then they practice this ancient art. It was very common in their days. They practiced something called single combat. And basically the idea was this. You send out a man, and we'll send out a man, our best fighters. They will fight to the death. And if your guy wins, we'll serve you. If we win, you serve us. Now the joy in that was this. If you win the fight in single combat, then your army gets to take control of the other army. Napoleon was incredible at this. He would send out his best warrior, have them fight. Often other armies would even give up before the battle took place. And so his army just kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger. They're saying, hey, nobody has to die here. We'll send out our guy, you send out your guy. They'll fight, only one man will die, and the rest of us, we'll serve whichever God wins. Fear is in the air. And so suddenly, the Philistines, they send out their best one. He's a combat warrior named Goliath. Now, I've heard some authors say that Goliath perhaps was some kind of a big oaf with some weird biological disease that caused him to be big, like Andre the Giant type big. I don't think the Bible describes him that way at all. If you really study out the story of Goliath, even though there's all kinds of theories, I'm sure that Goliath was a fierce warrior. He was giant. The Bible says he was 9 feet tall. Extra-biblical sources even say he was at least 7 to 9 feet tall. The Bible says that he had a coat of armor that weighed 125 pounds. You study out the stature of the Israelites, many of them probably didn't weigh 125 pounds. Goliath had 125 pounds of armor on. He had a spear like a weaver's rod, probably about 7 or 8 feet long. And at the end of that spear, just the tip of his spear, was a 15-pound spearhead. He was a massive, massive man to look at. And the Bible says that he walks out on the field and he begins to shout. Verse 8, Goliath shouts at the ranks of Israel, why do you come out and line up for battle? In other words, what are you guys even doing here? Aren't I a Philistine, and aren't you the servants of Saul? Choose a man and have him come down to me. See, everybody else in this entire battle is confused except for the giant. I will give Goliath one prop, and that's this. He knew what he was there for. Often what we do is we don't know what we're there for. Can I tell you, the enemy doesn't think you're cute? Can I tell you, the enemy wants your marriage to end? We have beautiful little kids in our church. Our kids' ministry is exploding, by the way, in our church. And I can tell you, listen, when the enemy sees them, the enemy saw this video, this cute little kid this morning. You know what he wants for her? He wants molestation. He wants death. He wants rape for her. He wants nothing. You get it? The giant of your life, he's not playing games. He wants to steal, kill, and ultimately destroy you. Goliath said, if your man is able to kill me, we'll become his subjects, but if I kill him, you'll become ours. The Philistine then says this, today I defy, get this, one guy defying an army, the armies of Israel. Wow. Give me a man, let us fight each other. And on hearing the Philistine's words, Saul and the whole Israel army, the Bible says they were afraid, they were terrified, they were dismayed. Now, verse 16, the next verse tells us the giant didn't just do this one day, but he came back day after day after day. Now, how many of you think, now the Bible doesn't say this, but how many of you think after like 30 days, he probably started getting creative, right? He's making up cuss words. He's so tired of talking about their mamas, he starts talking about their grandmamas. You hear what I'm saying? I mean, you can't talk about Nana. But he's doing it. Because why? Because nobody's going to fight him. He's cussing out their God. He keeps telling them, man, if your God, the living God, the Jehovah God that you say you worship, if he's so great, then how come I'm the only one brave enough to stand on the battlefield? Can you imagine how bad it must have gotten? How cocky he must have been. The Bible says he kept coming up. In other words, he kept edging further up the hill. He got bolder and bolder and bolder. See, giants, they never go away on their own. They cannot be negotiated with or run from. No, giants, they have to be killed or they will just keep coming back. Now, on the scene comes David. The Bible says David's about 17 at this time. He's the shepherd boy. He's now a lunch boy. He's bringing lunch to his brothers. The Bible calls him ruddy and handsome. Just kind of translation, he's sort of small, a little bit, just kind of looks like a mama's boy a little bit. He's not fully grown in his stature. He's obviously not a trained warrior. And he comes on the scene, and in verse 23, it says the giant comes forth and says his usual defiance. That's what the Bible says, usual defiance. Now, after 40 days, you've heard this so much that you're not even hearing it anymore. They're just over there like sipping tea or something while the giant's cussing out their God, because this happens every day. It's his usual defiance. But David, listen, he doesn't just hear it, he hears it. It goes past his ears into his spirit, and David gets angry. Can I tell you, we're going to talk, one of the giants we're going to talk about is the giant of anger, but there is a good form of anger. Jesus practiced this when he cleared out the temple. Listen, there is a godly anger that each of us needs to become familiar with. And it's not just, at this point, it's not just a defiance, it's a usual defiance. In other words, when is enough going to be enough? I mean that addiction that you've just been petting for years, when it finally gets your kids, will it be enough? Because, by the way, it will. David, he has incredible boldness. And the Bible says in verse 32, this is beautifully ridiculous. David goes to Saul, verse 32, and he says this, let no one lose heart on account of this giant. In other words, listen, Saul, I pulled up on my skateboard. I didn't know this was happening, or I would have come earlier. I was hanging out with my friends over at the skate park. And listen, nobody has to worry anymore because your boy is here. That's right. Now, can you imagine this? Saul is surrounded by like the Navy SEALs of their day. And David's like a sophomore in high school, you know? Pulled up and he's like, hey, guys, I know everybody's worried, but don't worry because I'm here. I'm here. I would have been here sooner, but I mean, I'm here now, and it's all good. And because now your servant, your boy, I'm going to fight him. And so everybody just take a break. Everybody go get some barbecue. Go back and just hang out because I got this. Wow. What a spirit that is inside of this kid. I got to tell you, I want a kid like this on my staff. Hey, man, I'll hire him. 17. We're good. No problem. We'll work out the details later. We need the spirit of David in our church. Amen? I want to have a mindset like David. I want to have a mindset that when everybody else is in the midst of this massive, you know, oh, it's just so hard and pastor, there's so much. Well, listen, not because of me, but because of the Spirit of God in me. Listen, don't worry, your boy is here. I've showed up and there's faith now. You might say, well, pastor, you're on the edge of pride. No, listen, confidence and pride aren't the same thing. Confidence is being sure in our God. Pride is being sure in ourselves. You get it? I want a church that has the Spirit of David. Pastor, it's hard, man, and a lot of churches are struggling out there, but don't worry, because your servant's in Inglewood. We're in the city, and we'll fight. Of course, you know how the story ends. The giant falls, and the army is motivated, and that day there's a great victory for David and for Israel. Now, very quickly this morning, I want to point something out. I usually don't use outlines, but this is such a big story. I want to share with you what I call three key truths from this story, three things I think God wants you to take home today. The first one is this. The first one is that your Goliath wants God's glory even more, get this, than he wants your freedom. Did you know that your freedom and God's glory are connected? Did you know that? And in fact, they are diametrically, utterly, irreversibly connected. They are inseparable. You have not been set free just for your freedom, but you have been set free so that God can get great glory. By the way, that's why God chooses the nobodies of the world. Everybody would have believed it if a great warrior stepped out and said, hey, I've really been working this weapon and so we're good. But no, when a little boy steps out, I mean, you know, God gets even greater glory. Because everybody looks at the story of David and says, that's not about David, that's about the power of our God. God doesn't look for trained warriors. God looks for people that have a heart after him. That's what David had. And John 15:8 tells us this, and you should read this later, that the spiritual fruit that is in our lives, that it is not for our glory, John 15:8, but it is for the Father's glory. And so when a giant, when a Goliath shows up in your life that will not go away, here's what happens. When you are robbed of freedom, get this, the Father is robbed of glory. Why is it important for me to be free? Just so that I can be free? Well, yeah, that's half of it. But you're missing the other side of the coin. I need to be free because my Father deserves the glory. Amen? Now, some of you might say, well, pastor, you know, it's not that big a deal. I mean, I'm not going to hurt the body of Christ because I have a private addiction. Well, here's what happens with that. First off, you're going to hurt the body of Christ because you're not walking in the Father's glory. You walk out of here this morning and you go home and you say, man, our God is big. He kills giants. But then that giant of addiction is waiting for you. It's the bottle sitting on your table. It's the drugs in the drawer. It's the pornography hidden in the screen. And it says, okay, I get it that you think your God is great, but I'm greater because I'm still here. Get that? Get that, army of Israel? If your God's so bad, then why am I so good? Why can I walk out here and be so cocky if your God is so great? Say, pastor, I think that, you know, my issues are kind of my issues. Well, the problem with that is that when that giant of depression shows up and you try to worship your God, that giant of depression says, hey, you better put your hands down because I'm actually bigger than your God. I'm still here. So why do we need to defeat giants? Not just for freedom's sake. That's only part of it. But for God's glory. Now I want to point something out. David was not in personal danger here. Honey, you know, David could have dropped off the food, headed north back to the mountains. But that's not what happened. David, there was no expectation that he would fight the giant. Nobody was going to say, hey, David, if you don't like, you know, you're going to fail with the rest of us. No, David wasn't even a part of the army. Nobody expected a kid to fight a giant. But David was not offended because he was in personal danger. David was offended when he heard that the giant was talking up against his God. If you read the story closely, you'll find verse 45. David said to the Philistine, you come against me with sword, spear, and javelin. I come against you in the name of the Lord God, the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day, I'm not going to deliver you. God's going to deliver you. Now look at the next verse. The Bible says this. The whole world will know that there's a God in Israel. That one sentence tells you why David is so mad. The whole world is thinking that his God can be challenged. David's going to say, no, you don't understand. My God doesn't need a spear or a javelin or a sword or any other form of weapon. No. The battle here, it's not even my battle. It's God's battle. And he is going to give you into our hands. Now listen, my freedom story, And I don't have time to tell my testimony today, but my freedom story and your freedom story is for God's glory. Amen? My freedom story is not just so I have a story. My freedom story is for God's glory. Say it with me. My freedom story, it's for God's glory. Your freedom story, it's for God's glory. So why does the giant have to go? Because he can't have even one more ounce of the glory of my God. Key truth number two, small battles prepare you for big giants. I have always loved how this public battle in the Valley of Elah is connected back to the private battles that David fought in lonely shepherd fields outside of Bethlehem. The Bible is very clear that David has been prepared by God for this battle. I love to read the interview part of the story. This is the interview. It's found in verses 34 through 37. David says to Saul, your boy, David, your servant, I'm here. And here's the deal. I'm well prepared for this moment because I've been taking care of my dad's sheep. And here's what happened, Saul. A lion came one day to kill one of my sheep. And that was like basic training for this moment. I grabbed the lion by the Spirit of God and by the hair. I mean, you know, shepherd boys are not expected to wrestle lions, right? If I'm a shepherd boy, I'm just going, you know, I took care of most of the sheep. I mean, a few got ate, but I mean, that's just part of the deal, right? I even ate a few. I got hungry. You know, that's it. No. David is being faithful when nobody is watching. The lion turned on him. He struck it and killed it. And then the next one says this, your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. I love this line. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them. That's like Christian cussing right there. That's really bad. It's really bad. Uncircumcised. He's talking about him bad right there. Because he has defied the armies of the living God. And the Lord, the same God who rescued me from the lion and the bear. Well, this giant, that's no big deal for him. Amen? In other words, David instinctively connects his history, get this, follow this, with the mystery of the giant he's about to face. Just because you haven't fought a battle yet doesn't mean that God hasn't prepared you for that battle. Listen, your history is connected to the mystery of what you're about to face. Absolutely. David had never fought a trained Philistine infantry soldier before. But that doesn't mean that he lacked experience. No. Now listen, the same God who defeated the lions and the bears while nobody was watching is the same God that will defeat the giant while everybody is watching. Look at what happens next. Saul then offers his personal armor to David. 1 Samuel 17, David strapped on the sword of his armor and he tried in vain to go, but he had not tested them. David said to Saul, I cannot go in these. I've not tested them. NIV says that I've not ever used anything like this before. So he put them off. No, listen. David is this ruddy boy. Saul, the Bible says, stood head and shoulders above everybody else in Israel. So how many think the armor's too big? Amen? Saul's going, David, I got the best stuff, man. I tell you, I got this incredible Kevlar Gore-Tex lined armor. It's amazing. Yeah, this is what you need. This is how we fight battles right here. Here's my sword. Here's my shield. Here's my helmet. But I got to tell you, if you've never worn that stuff, I mean, that's David's swimming in it, man. It's taken his agility. It's stole his vision. And he's saying, I can't use this. And so what does David do? He picks up the weapons of a shepherd boy, a stick and a sling. Now, that sling was like think about a pouch about a little bigger than your hand. And it would have four long strips of leather, sometimes as much as 2 or 3 feet long. And in their day, they had infantry soldiers. They had soldiers that like rode in chariots. And then they had projectile soldiers. They had soldiers that would have a bow. And then many, many armies would have hundreds of soldiers, if not thousands, who they called them slingers. Now, I did a little study on this, and there's actually nerds who have studied this. And they say that when a slinger in their day would pick up a rock, and their rocks were very weighty there, that they would take that sling and they would sling it around, sometimes 6, 8, 10 times. It would have massive velocity. And then when they would let it go, a stone in their day fired out of a sling from a skilled slinger could go as fast as 100 feet in less than a second. If you do the ballistics on that, they say they've studied this out. They say that's as fast as a 45 caliber round being fired out of a handgun. Now listen, the ballistics are there, right? David could kill that giant. They say experienced slingers in that day could have reasonable accuracy out to 200 yards. If you were within 50 yards, they could knock a tin can off of your head. Now, what I don't like about this story is when preachers spiritualize it too much. I heard guys say, well, David, he picked up 5 rocks, right? Because Goliath had 5 brothers. There is absolutely no biblical proof that Goliath had 5 brothers that David killed. The Bible does tell us about one giant that was killed that was a descendant of Goliath, but David didn't kill him. So it didn't happen. It just didn't. Can I tell you why David picked up 5 rocks? Because if you miss, you got 4 more shots. I mean, that's good right there. And there's probably only 5 because you only got so big of pockets, you know. I mean, what are you going to do, you know? And I've heard preachers say it like this. Well, David, you know, slung that sling around, and the Holy Spirit was on it, and it, like there was an angel involved and anointing and all that. And it's just like God supercharged the rock. And no. David was good with that weapon. A giant 100 feet away, no contest. You might say, well, Pastor, you're ruining the story. I mean, I want to know that God. No, listen. It's the weapons you develop in private that one day God will use in public. Now listen, it's not whether or not the story's spiritual enough. Get this. It's whether or not your history is godly enough. Here's a good question. Has your godly history prepared you for the giants you're about to face? Pastor, I'm going to face some great giants. For those of you that are young, I right now am discipling about 10 future ministers in our church. And I love it. It's my favorite part of my job. But I can tell you, man, you want to be great in the kingdom of God? Your battles, this, what I'm doing here, public stage, it's a very small part of preparation for God using you. You know where my first sermons were preached? The very first public sermon I ever preached was at my college dorm area. There's about 10 guys meeting for a Bible study, and one they let me preach. I had never preached before, so I prepared 20 hours for a 10-minute talk. I was serious. And I did a little, I still have the notes on it. I did a little 10-minute talk on joy, but that wasn't my first sermon. My first sermons were in the prayer room down the hall from my bedroom. They had this prayer room, and there were seats in there and stuff, and I often was in there by myself. And nobody knew me, but I knew I was called to preach, and nobody was asking me, so I didn't have an audience. But when you got to preach in you, you got to preach in you. Amen? So I just started writing sermons. And then I would go, and I would imagine a bunch of unsaved people in the chairs in the prayer room, and I would preach to the chairs. Those were the holiest chairs. They got saved, delivered. I anointed them with oil. I took offerings. I mean, it was crazy. But I would preach to the chairs. In fact, I used to say it like this. I wish I could preach like I could pray, because I considered that pray preaching, you know, because I was in a prayer room, so pray preaching. And here's the thing, listen. The weapon I developed when nobody is watching is now the weapon God uses all the time when everybody is watching. Get it? Now listen. If you lose the small battles of your life, you're going to end up serving the giants of your life. You say, Pastor, I I'm not fighting any big public battles right now. Well, that's okay. In fact, I love this. This is God's word to you. God always chooses nobodies from nobody, nowhere, right? Because he gets the greatest glory when that happens. When people watch the success of my life in ministry, listen, what I hear all the time is, I just can't believe it. I just can't believe it. It's got to be God. And I go, absolutely, absolutely. Because when God chooses somebody that they don't even believe it could happen, then God gets all the glory. Amen? So listen. If you're faithful when no one is watching, then God will prepare you for victory when everybody's watching. And you might say, well, I'm not called to preach. Well, let me tell you one thing you are called to do. You're called to spend time in God's presence. David took the shepherd fields, and instead of looking at them like they were demotion, he saw them as a promotion to spend time with God. Now, listen, when I left for Bible college, I got saved when I was 16. I left for Bible college when I was 18 and a half. When I was 16, I lived in my parents' basement. I had my own little apartment down there. They had just kind of given up when they got to me. And so it was like, do whatever you want. And so I went to this apartment, and I had built a little bench in shop class. And it was just this beautiful little bench. My mom still has it. And I called it my prayer bench. And I set it in the corner of my little basement apartment. And every day, there were days I would spend 3 and 4 hours in prayer before that bench. I didn't know what I was doing or saying. Nobody had really taught me. I just knew I needed God's presence. When I left for Bible college, I thought, well, I gotta give this bench to my mom. So I picked it up, and the shadow of the bench had been covering the carpet. And my knees had literally worn all the way through the padding, through the carpet, to where there was bare floor. I can tell you this. Listen. That home, we no longer own that home. I couldn't go. They probably have replaced the carpet. I wish I had cut out the little patch and framed it and put it on my wall. Because I believe that those private moments of fighting my lion and my bear are the reasons why I kill giants all the time now. You get it? Has your godly history prepared you for the mystery of what you're about to face? And finally, the last one is this, and we're done. And that is this, and I know I'm going a little long, but here we are. Full defeat demands full victory. Goliath was killed with a rock and a sling, but then something amazing happened. The Bible says in verse 50, David triumphed over the Philistine with the rock and the sling, but then he does something weird. Here it is. You got it? Okay. Then he does something weird. The Bible says David ran and stood over the giant. He stood over the giant. Now in their culture, it was probably very humble, you know, just kind of, you know, very humble. We're Americans, right? We would have been like, what are you doing now? You know, kind of thing. I don't hear you talking now. Hey, that's a weird pimple on your forehead right there. I mean, we would have been like, yeah, you know what I'm saying? And then the Bible says that enough wasn't enough for David. So what does David do? He pulls out the sword of Goliath. Get this. And he cuts off the head of Goliath. Now, I picture, this is just me, not Bible, me, I picture David holding up the head. I picture him turning around to the army and saying, he ain't talking now. You know what I'm saying? This guy was cussing out my God. Oh, what? I can't hear you, gross head thing. You know what I'm saying? I actually contemplated when I was writing this sermon, I was like going to some costume shop and having some weird thing to hold up. I just thought I would gross everybody out and scare children, so I didn't. Where's your usual defiance now, Goliath? The Bible tells us that the Philistines were routed. Now look at this verse 54. David took the Philistine's head back to Jerusalem. I have no idea what David wanted to do with a weird head. But then he does this. He takes the weapons of the Philistine and he puts them in his own tent. Now listen. You can throw the verses up. We have good biblical evidence that David would lose that sword because of all the running from Saul. But a few chapters later, chapter 21, verses 8 and 9, the Bible tells us that David goes to see this priest, and there's some of Saul's men there, so David gets a little scared. He doesn't have a weapon with him. So he says to the priest, he says, do you like have any swords? Do you have any weapons? And the priest says, I've only got one. But he goes back and he gets it from behind the ephod, and he pulls it out, and it's no ordinary sword. It's the sword of Goliath. Now David says this, there's no other sword like that one. Now listen, we have decent biblical evidence, we have better extra biblical evidence, that the sword of Goliath became David's sword. Now listen, in just one little battle one day, David killed 200 Philistines. If you study out his life, you'll find that David didn't kill one or two giants, David killed thousands of giants. In fact, at one point, David had killed so many men that he was afraid that God would not bless him because there was so much blood on his hands. In other words, this giant killer was not a giant killer. He was a killer of giants. Amen? Now listen, get this in your spirit. When are you going to get some fight in you? When are you going to get some fight in you? Seriously. I stood with my daughter this past week. She's 13. And at her school, there's a lot of boys walking down the hallway holding hands of boys and girls walking down. You get what I'm saying, that culture. I don't have to say anymore. She was confused by it and just frustrated by it. Just didn't know it. It scares her a little bit. And it should scare all of us, by the way. But I just felt this thing. I had literally just finished. I just typed the last line of my sermon. My daughter comes home from school and starts telling me this. Literally, I mean, within 3 minutes apart. So I'm just typing about being a giant killer, then she walks in and tells me about a giant. And I don't know why, but I normally would have just comforted her and said, it'll be okay, and here's what the Bible says. But this time around, I just felt like I just needed to call a warrior out of her. So I went in my office and I got a book by Erwin McManus called The Barbarian Way. He talks about being a warrior for God. And I said, honey, my daughter's a reader, but I said, this is above your reading level, spiritually, not physically. But I said, I'm going to give it to you anyway, and I want you to read it. And then I just hugged her, and I began to prophesy over her. Now, you might think I'm weird, but I just started saying, you're the head, you're not the tail, you're the warrior, you're not the victim. And I just kept telling her, I said, honey, we live in an evil world, but it doesn't mean that you can't stand up for purity. And I just started calling a warrior spirit out of her. But I was serious, within 3 minutes, she was crying, I was crying, just this weird moment in our kitchen. That was 3 days ago. If I could, I would do it for every one of you individually this morning. Because listen, you're not going to have full victory while you wait on giants and only deal with them when they come. You get it? God wants you to be a hunter of giants. Listen, if you really get this sermon, you'll wake up tomorrow morning, put your feet on the floor, and then say, where's a giant? Because I'm awake. I got bad good news for you. Giant killers kill giants. You get it? Well, I'm a giant killer. Well, how many you killed? How many you killed? How many? Some of you get mad at me for this, but I'm a turkey hunter. What's up with Thanksgiving, by the way? I know a lot of guys who say they're turkey hunters, and every time I talk to anybody that says I'm a hunter, I always say, well, what have you got? You know, because I'm not just hunting, I'm shooting them, right? You're not really a hunter until you're not a fisherman until you catch a fish. You're not a leader if you're not leading anybody. You know, a good definition of a leader: a person with followers. Right? There it is. So you don't tell me you're a giant killer if you're not killing giants. No, giant killers kill giants. And you know what David did? all the rest of the giants he started killing, they weren't giants for him. David started going around to towns and going, oh, the Philistines have been bothering you? I'll take care of that. Oh, I heard they were messing with you. Let's go over there and kill all of them. Before it was all said and done, by the time David was the age of 25, he had 400 Navy SEALs of his own. The Bible says they could shoot accurately with bow and arrow from the right and the left on a horse. That's something. There was one of David's warriors. Man, he took on like 100 men all by himself to the point that they literally had to pry the sword away from his hand. David became the leader of warriors. Amen? So listen, if you're not killing giants, then you're just not a giant killer. But God has called you to be a giant killer. Amen? So it's time to go on the offensive. You might say, well, Pastor, how do I pick a fight with my personal giant? Well, it'd be a little bit like picking a fight with the bully at your school, you know. I hope there's no kids in the room right now, but you know, you just walk up, punch him in the face. That'll do it right there. Every time it'll be on in that moment. Listen, giants are never killed by accident. Intentionality is required. And so if you look closely, everybody stand. If you look closely at the story of David, the Bible tells us this. David runs to see what's happening. David runs to Saul, tells him that he's his man, he's going to kill the giant. David runs out, verbally confronts Goliath. Nobody told him to do it. David runs to the battle line to meet Goliath. The Bible tells us that when Goliath finally had enough, and he's like, you come at me with like a stick, he called him stick boy, and so David, Goliath starts charging at David. Can you imagine just what that must have sounded like? Now, if I'm David, I just go like plant, you know, because I won't get a good shot. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says when Goliath ran at David, David ran at Goliath. Study out the physics of that. David hit him on the run. Amen? And then when that was all said and done, even more intentionality. He's dead. Well, he's going to be dead now. I'm going to walk over, cut his head off. The intentionality of this story is shocking. And yet we just go, well, I don't know, I might kill one today, maybe not, who knows? No. Courageous trust combined with this audacious intentionality. Full faith, like we talked about during Grave Robber, combined with aggressive obedience. There are no giants who can stand. Amen? I'm coming at you so fast, so hard, I'm going to obey God before you can even spell God. Amen? You get that in your spirit. I don't know. I heard there was a big fight last night. Somebody won, whatever. But it's just, when you going to be a fighter? You know? Get it in your spirit. I'm truly, when it's physical world, I'm a lover, not a fighter. I promise you. But spiritual world? Seriously, I wake up some days and I'm just bored, so I go pick a fight. Let's just go take some new territory. Let's do some. I'm saying we already got that covered. Let's go start a new ministry. Let's go punch the devil in the face. Some angle that we've not got yet. You know, you get it? Get that in your spirit, and you got it. Amen. Now, one last piece of good news, and we're done. It's the first week of an 8-week series, so here it is. Listen, I love this angle. God wants you to be a giant killer. But if you are not a Christian yet today, you're not capable of killing giants yet. Now, I'm not saying you can't be the underdog and, you know, win the football game or something. But when it comes to actual giant killing, actual spiritual freedom that comes from killing a giant, you can't do that until the Spirit of God's in your heart. But I've got great news for you. I love this, man. I could have just said this and then went home. Jesus is Pastor, I'm so broken and I'm so messed up and I've got so many habits. I don't belong on the field. I agree, but here's good news. Jesus is already on the field. Amen? Jesus is your David. And in fact, I think we way too much preach about us being David. I really do. I like that angle. It's okay. But the better angle is I'm not David at all. Jesus is David. Amen? How many of you know Jesus never misses when it comes to forgiveness? Amen? Jesus never misses when it comes to freedom. Amen? So Jesus is your David. And if you say, Pastor, I just don't know if I'm there yet. I don't know if I'm a David yet. Well, then I like your humility. God blesses the humble. So you take this angle instead. When you go home, you tell all your giants that, you know what, I'm a little scared still, but I got good, bad news for you. My older brother is here. Amen? Amen? And he never misses. Amen? I remember that a few times when I was little. I have an older brother, and I remember a few times, you know, a bully, and I'm just like, you're the man when the older brother's behind you. You know? So you can be confident in the Lord because Jesus is your David. I want you to bow your head, close your eyes right where you are. Father, come on, lift your hands, just begin to receive. Father, I pray over our people. My pastor heart is coming out today. We live in the land of giants. God, the Valley of Elah is not some place we visit. It's where we live. And there are Goliaths of massive proportion standing in this room. And they're big, they're scary, they've got longevity. But today, Lord, you're our David. And good news, the Spirit that raised Christ from the dead is in us. So giants, come on, you do this in your own life. Just whisper it. I put you on notice in the name of the Lord. I will no longer, come on, pray this. I will no longer be on the defensive. I'm going on the offense in Jesus' name. Now, if you need to accept Christ in your life, if you need to be right with God before you step on this battlefield, then I'd like you to pray this out loud with me. I just don't feel led to ask for a response this morning, but I want you to pray it out loud. And please be sure to fill out a card at the end if this is a first time in a long time for you. You just write that on your connection card and hand it in at the door. But let's pray this. Let's pray this together. Let's pray this out loud. Jesus, I thank you that on the cross you defeated every giant that I will ever face. The giant of sin bows at your grace. The giant of addiction bows at your freedom. You conquered the grave. So today I give you my life. Invade my space. Set me free in Jesus' name. Father, I pray over your people. We've just been watching life transformation take place week after week after week. And I just feel like this Sunday that you've just turned the temperature up. And I've never prayed for this over an audience, but I feel led to do it. I pray that a righteous anger would just well up inside of your people. We're facing the fight of the century in our own lives. Come on, ask him this. Give me the Spirit of Christ. That same Spirit that was in David. Give it to me. Put me on the offensive in my life. And help me to kill the giants. In Jesus' name. Amen. Come on. What a great God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Man, this is going to be a good series, guys. And I'll tell you, a series, again, it represents a season for the life of a church. And if that is true, by God's Spirit, then this is going to be a season of freedom. Amen. This is going to be a season when all, listen, I believe this, not just because I'm preaching it. I really believe all the giants in your life could be dead by the end of June. Amen? Amen? Every one of them. If I were you, if there was ever a season, I know I say this every time because I'm in love with whatever we're doing, but But I really believe this. If there was ever a season when you just said, I'm just not going to miss a Sunday. I'm just not going to. I really believe God's going to do something. Listen, this is it. Even next week, even with the Mother's Day thing, I'm sticking with this series. And we're going to watch God do something great. Be an awesome time to bring a friend. We'll be kind of recapping this first week every single week. And so you can catch up pretty easy. God bless you guys. Have an awesome rest of the day. Take care.